The nightclub shootout is probably the most iconic scene in the original Terminator film. When I first saw the movie at age 12 with some friends and family, we were a bit bored during the first half an hour because we had no clue what the film was about. A big beefy guy assassinating women for some unknown reason, and another guy running about avoiding the cops, but where's the story? And it was the nightclub shootout that made us all sit up and say, "Whoa, this is a fucking great movie," even though Reese hadn't explained the plot yet. Obviously the scene's appealing because it's a fast but well choreographed action sequence helped by the flashy nightclub visuals. But watching it more carefully from a filmmaker's perspective and in HD, I recently noticed several things that I've not noticed before. So let's go through the whole nightclub sequence right from the beginning. Sarah is stalked by a cold-faced guy in a Mac, and though it turns out he's not a flasher, he does have a whopper phallic shotgun hiding under his coat. She enters into the nightclub for safety, and immediately the visual metaphors are all over the place. Reese passes the red Tech Noir sign outside the club, indicating the stylistic fusion between science fiction and film noir gangster movies. The metallic decor inside the club foreshadows the cyber nightmare future that awaits humanity. It's got crosshatch metal, a wired fence upon entry, and a lot of the club has sheet metal fence walls. It all looks like a big metallic prison cage that the happy-go-lucky clubbers have already been herded into, but don't yet realise it. It's got flashing strobes and spotlights, as if the herd are being watched over by those big hunter-killer ships and those robot vehicles that Reese dreamed about earlier. The big Tech Noir sign above the bar flashes away, subtly suggesting the sense of emergency for Sarah. The two songs we hear in the club are by Tarney Kane and the Triangles. The first song is called Photoplay. Reese fell in love with Sarah when he was given her photograph. The Terminator is about to memorise her photo after finding it in her apartment. And funnily enough, the song includes the line, "victim of rape," that sexual threat thing again. So Sarah starts making phone calls, and there's a nice joke from her friend Ginger's answering machine saying that she's talking to a machine, which funnily enough Sarah is, being that the Terminator has listened to the call.
"Hi there. Fooled you. You're talking to a machine. But don't be shy, it's okay. Machines need love too. So talk to it, and Ginger, that's me."
An advance clue that he's not human. And she says machines need love too. Not quite the case here, but there are assorted hints in the story that there's a hidden emotional side to the Terminator. Sarah talks to the cops, who tell her to wait there. So she sits down, and even the tables and chairs are made of metal hatching, and each has one of those cage-protected lights usually found in industrial workplaces. So Terminator steps in and pushes a black guy out the way. No racial theme there, it's just incidental. And he moves around the wire fence with a casualness that sort of looks like the fence is moving aside for him. Here we get a great little visual joke. The doorman is wearing a t-shirt with a sort of x-ray skeleton image on it, and it's he who gets all the bones crushed in his hand. So the shirt emphasises his organic skeletal structure in comparison to the Terminator's harder frame. So Terminator wanders about among the smoke and moving spotlights. We moved on to the second song, which is called Burning in the Third Degree, and the lyrics are really poignant. It's a love song which includes the lyric, "See the flicker gleaming in your eyes, it catches me." And Sarah and Reese do make their first direct eye contact here among flickering lights. But as well as being appropriate to the love story element, the song includes the line, "I'm your prisoner." And yeah, these people are all imprisoned but don't know it yet. And the chorus, "You got me burning," sure, it's a sexual reference in the original song context, but these people are soon going to be burning in a nuclear fire. Appropriate that they're dancing under red light. So everyone's dancing away while Sarah, Reese and the Terminator are comparatively still, miserable fucks. And by the way, both Reese and the Terminator are dressed in cold metallic grey, with the studs and chains on Terminator's jacket, a hint of his steel frame. The slow motion thing does several things here. Ginger's murder occurred in slow motion, so it's an implication Sarah is about to die in the same way. It also prolongs that first eye contact moment, and it sets a deceptive pacing that makes the following gun battle feel more fast-paced and frenetic by comparison. The eye contact with Reese is mixed with the Terminator's boom 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 music, suggesting the possibility Reese is a robotic killer too. Sarah's face flares in emergency red as she sees him, and the sudden cavernous echo effect of the club music sort of pulls us out of the environment, like in this moment only Sarah and Reese exist. It's a good combination of elements. T-1000 Terminator finally spots Sarah, and on the back wall behind him there are light fittings designed like those big transformer electrode things found in power stations, and they have a red neon bar running between them, like lightning. Such devices were famously seen during the creation of Frankenstein's monster. So seeing the Terminator himself stood between them is obviously a visual statement about his electrically powered construction, and maybe a Frankenstein's monster reference. Now Terminator goes in for the kill. We can see on the left side here that some of the lights appear to actually be police car strobes built into the walls. It helps enhance the sense of emergency. And the handgun's red dot beam shining right into the camera lens is like a form of direct eye contact from Terminator's red electronic eye itself. Reese is going for the kill as well, and we get the important revelation that he's on his side. It's a great moment combined with a nice bit of Coke is it product placement. I'd have been tempted to throw in a joke, someone snorting a line in the background. By the way, it's quite easy to miss in the full speed footage. The Terminator does actually fire at Sarah, but because Reese's first shot hit him in the forearm, it knocks the gun out of the way so that the bullet just misses her. That's why we see him fixing a forearm wound later. So Reese unloads most of his shotgun ammo just to knock the Terminator down. He gets up, and though it's easy to overlook, Reese shows a bit of his own brutality by using a bystander as a human shield. Yes, he does, he actually grabs the guy and holds him in place. It may seem cold, but hey, he's trying to save the fucking human race here. This poor fellow's probably going to be roasted by a nuclear bomb soon anyway. So fast and agile, Reese dives behind the bar and fires off his last round to try and draw the Terminator's fire away from Sarah. Arnie's single-handed firing of the Uzi is great because it shows his strength. Another bystander takes a hit to help save the human race. Then Spider-Man Reese dives for cover again, quickly repositioning himself. So it seems that generally staying in one place during a shootout with a Terminator is a bad idea, but Reese knows what he's doing. Keep moving, keep your enemy confused about your position. And that's good because as tough as the Terminator is, he's a bit clunky in the movement department. Humans still have the upper hand in terms of speed and agility. Terminator also reveals its lack of perfection here by trying to shoot Reese but running out of bullets. This robot ought to have had some sort of internal counter keeping a check on the ammo as it's being used. Must have forgot, eh? Sound-wise, there's some sort of beeping that I always thought was an alarm system in the club, but I think it's actually part of the music. It adds a good subliminal touch to the feeling of emergency, along with the flickering strobe light. Terminator approaches Sarah for the final kill, and with not a hint of hesitation. Good low camera angles to make him imposing too. And if Reese had been a single second later in his intervention, she'd be dead, and he'd have to hang around and do John Connor's job for him. What a bummer that would have been. Again, speed over strength is emphasised here. Reese is really fast in his firing and reloading. Blasting Terminator through the window and out of the club is like a statement in itself. They should have made Reese the doorman. Though I have to issue a complaint here. The original Terminator film had a mono soundtrack to save on budget, not that anyone really cared. But to upscale the sound for the DVD and Blu-ray releases, someone redid all the gunfire effects, and they did a crap job of it. The original sounds from the shotgun and Uzi were really meaty, but now the Uzi sounds like someone popping bubble wrap. The shotgun hasn't got as much punch either, and no, the sound of the bullets hitting Terminator's metal frame doesn't make up for it. In fact, it's wrong, because the speed of the bullets would mean that the sound of the shotgun and sound of impact at this close range would be simultaneous. But the sound re-engineers were probably trying to imitate the bullet sounds from Saving Private Ryan. I recently noticed a similar thing with the gun battles in Scarface. Perfectly good, meaty gunfire sounds replaced in the Blu-ray version with pathetic pop gun effects. Who the fuck did they hire to do these audio re-edits? I can't even find the original mono audio for Terminator anymore. Thanks a lot, dickhead re-editors. Okay, rant over. So finally we get a bit of dialogue, and it's a great barroom chat-up line from Reese.
Come with me if you want to live.
I'll have to try that one out when I'm next on the town. But the line also retains a bit of his dangerous streak, being that a malicious abductor could speak the same line as a threat. Finishing off the scene, Terminator recovers again and gets up to give chase. The smoke emanating from the hot gunshot wounds in his chest is a good touch. It would have been easy to forget to add that detail. And the way in which he gives chase is quite funny. If he just got up fast like we'd expect an emotionless robot to, it wouldn't have looked very dramatic. But having him slowly rise, tower above a very low camera angle, then slowly build up into a chase is excellent. It infuses the Terminator with a sense of emotion, like he's building into a rage of anger for having his assassination attempt thwarted. He's in such a rage that he forgets to pick up the Uzi 9mm which he just reloaded a minute ago. He's probably so mad he just wants to tear them apart with his bare hands. Like Frankenstein's monster, he has feelings. Of sorts. Oh, last detail, well done to the costume department for not giving Sarah high heels. Okay, thanks for watching, hope you enjoyed that. If you want to live, then subscribe. Follow me on Facebook and Twitter, and check out the many digital downloads on my site.
Give me your address there.
Sure, buddy, it's collativelearning.com.